And by Kong Doom Monster, really just don't want to give that over to Key. It's had some hit or miss performances on it. Lately, it's been more hits than misses, I suppose. So
he's had a hit or miss season, I think, Achilles. He's one of the guys who had the highest expectations from ESC. But just think of his game in the last on the Braum. It's actually been Totoro that's been the more important, impressive Braum player from ESC ever. And the build also going for a second full item, Guardian Angel. Really didn't provide much utility for his team compared to the Zeke's Herald on the side of Guga's Trundle. But the bans are coming in thick and fast, and Kongdu don't really have to change too much.
Yeah, they're going to ban everything exactly the same. The Varus even being banned by them despite having that first pick potential. So it looks like they might want to just leave something a bit more powerful up. They could go back into that Gangplank here as the Echo is banned away. So we're going to have the... just about the exact same band Celia swapped out for the Rek'Sai.
Worth noting also that we will once again see Fire Trap. No doubt Crazy is at the studio, but at least for game two, they will not be playing him. And honestly, you blind pick Gangplank and got great value from it in game one. Why change anything?
Well, Lunar is there if Fire Trap wants to play it into this. Let's see, but Rek'Sai up here. Ares, this was one of his more impressive champions on Monday, so we could see this as a first-round pickup for him. Wouldn't be too shocking.
Certainly been one of the cornerstones of his champion pool, but, I mean, Eris, his early game on Hecarim was outstanding. One of the best early-game Hecarim performances we've seen all season, but made some questionable decisions in the late game, which, again, we were talking about defying expectation. Consistent damage Syndra build. Eris excelling in the early game, but letting things go away in the late game. Every best of five has its own meta. But all we know is that Eris, Rek'Sai is ultra comfort for him.
That it is. So that will be locked in. Looks like we'll just have the Sivir picked up here as well for Loken, despite the Jhin being available. So doesn't want to opt into that pick for himself. So had a strong performance on this Sivir. He's had a strong performance so far throughout the promotion tournament. Definitely looking like a different player compared to in the regular split. So it just goes to show that Loken is only good when relocation's on the line.
Are we going to do an MSI 2016 just to have all the same picks? Cause so far, so good.
It's,
I guess the Rek'Sai is one small adaptation,
yeah.
But otherwise, the four champions have gone same as the previous game.
Well, looks like might divert away from the path a little bit further here now, as we can see the hover over the Vladimir. Something that was ignored in game one. Could be coming out now that the Talia is banned away here from Temp, but Jhin and Trundle is going to be that comfortable bot lane here yet again for Sol and Guger. They were keeping up in CS early on, kept trying to make those picks happen, weren't able to find them, but
yes,
weren't falling behind crucially.
They're going for the late game special. Sivir, Vladimir, and Shen. The late game has provided them a lot of options. The Shen play from Fire Trap is good in lane. Necessarily make titanic plays outside. The taunt flash is certainly one of the highest standards, but again, we know exactly what this comp from ESC does. We thought we did in game one and didn't quite get that result, so a bit more reliable, a jungle pick from the Rek'Sai, so probably going to be a bit more conservative from Ares here. Where do Kongdu want to go to round out their draft? Seems pretty clear, and it's going to be the Malzahar versus Vlad, which has been many mid laners' preferred take into that Vlad.
Yeah, that's a little bit of the question mark of them going to that Vladimir and saving this first pick, or this last pick, I should say, for their support role instead. So Malzahar coming through from Edge, going to be quite happy with that matchup, and Gragas coming out now for Punch in the jungle.
So two options, as you can see here for Key. Engage is something that this cop can do in terms of speed, but they don't really have someone to really set up a Shen. I guess Ghost Flash Protobelt Vladimir, but that's optimistic. Could also go for the Braum. Not necessarily the comp that necessitates Braum. When you think of Syndra plus Jhin, definitely Braum is massively powerful. When it's just the Jhin, I guess you could say the Gragas Barrel as well, so maybe there is some options there, but not a lot of value for the Braum against Malzahar. Regardless, ESC, a similar comp, but the more reliable jungler. And the late game trio, the Vladimir here, is the real insurance that will tip ESC over the edge in terms of team fights late game.
Yeah, I mean, having that Hemo plug dropped and all the Ricochet crits bouncing through, it's going to absolutely red Kong Doom Monster if they can get to that point.
I mean, 10% more of a lot is certainly going to be Sivir running through late game team fights. But again, we thought we understood what was happening in game one until Kong Doom just kind of turned the game. So Let's see if ESC can really tighten up their shot calling in the mid to late game, because those disjointed engages really cost them in game one.
Yeah, we also need to see if Kongju Monster is going to be able to have a better performance in the early game, because really just came off of that turnaround that they were able to find victory in game one. To make more proactive moves. Granted, getting the first brick, getting the double mountain drake early on was nice, but they're severely lacking in kills and starting to slip behind in the CS and the gold numbers. So we'll look to see if they can improve that level of performance, and if EFC, if they can actually get a lead, if they can hold on to it, maintain that, and ride it all the way through to the Nexus.
Kongju once again get a safe gangplank farming lane, and while he was ganked relentlessly in game one, it still felt like Gangplank was a big impact on the game.
Yes, he was. It took him a while to get there, but let's go ahead and get right onto the rip for game two. Kongju Monster looking for match point against ESC to knock them out of LCK contention. Let's get right into it. All right, Infernal Drake.
Hey!
It actually exists.
So beautiful.
So we get this nice scanted view of Summoner's Rift. Take a little bit of a photo tour right there. But our first Infernal Drake start of the promotion tournament here.
So Kongju Monster's plan in the early to mid game, obviously try to help Roach as much as possible in the early laning phase so he doesn't die, but moving away from that, the one thing you can really do with this comp here from Kongju is the moment you have level 6 from your mid laner and your bot laner, if you can set up pink wards around the Baron and leave lane, it is so risky for anyone to try to walk through the banana brush, to walk through the mid lane to contest around a Drake. Because if Malzahar ults someone, Jhin can respond from so far away, they can basically, with just two ultimates, delete anyone off the map. So Kongju's control over the bottom river, specifically around Drake, really puts them in the driver's seat to monopolize the Dragon Controller
face.
Hey, another ex-Najin player in Wolf.
Well, don't show the can. You're not allowed to show those on stream. Remember, we don't like sponsorships or advertisements, so we're gonna evade that. But just coming to hang out, check out his former, you know, support a former team here.
But this is
can't really call them nuts.
That's true. Well, I mean,
they are, but they're not.
So the reason why we can is that when OGN shows the team, they give them Najin's champion stars from their champion's win many moons ago in winter 2012, 2013. So from OGN's perspective, they are Najin. So that's why we see so many old faces. That's four now.
Oh,
that made it here.
Soul walking forward, looking for that crit on the Loken. Can't find the final shot. Minions running a bit too much damage, so he'll peel back. But yeah, I mean, saying that they're like Najin is sort of like being like a guy trying to like flirt with a girl, be like, yeah, I work at a Goldman Sachs, and you're like the coffee kid. Like, you're not actually, you're not like a broker. Like, you don't make these hundreds of thousands of dollars every year. You just fetch coffee for those that do.
Some of these players were actually part of the Najin extended roster from their last season in 2015 summer, and obviously now are starting players. Much was made of Kongju throwing together a roster at the last minute, and it certainly looked like that back in spring, but credit to them. The identity they've shown in three games of LCK Summer and in winning Challenger is that this team has leveled up a lot with that time to practice.
I just hope that if Kongju Monster do make it back into LCK here today or on Saturday, that they just have a better split than they did in spring, because it was pretty abysmal. But already, it seems like this time in Challenger really has worked for them. It seems like there's a lot of improvements. The addition of Punch seems to be very solid. And Roach as well, coming out in the top lane as the starter over top of Hitler. So seems like they've made the right moves and improvements where they can actually have some success that might just rival that of MVP.
Well, early days for them, and the game will be a different one in 2017 spring, but it's good to see the organization that could have gone really anyway when they, what was so woeful in spring season, clearly level up in Challenger. It was a surprise to see them beat the undefeated Spenno in the final, it's worth noting, but watching those VODs, it was a pretty comfortable win for them. It wasn't a competitive series, and they've already outlasted Spenno so far in this relegation tournament.
Yeah, that wasn't that much of a task, though. Punch now getting engaged on has to flash over the wall away from Ares. Fire Trap moving down, threatening that flash taunt. He just had to bail out. And now Ares tracking him into the jungle. But Punch has an idea that this might be happening. Now he's going to go back into this Gromp. Ares coming over the wall. We'll have the knockup. Doesn't have the red buff for the slow anymore. But Punch without that flash. Flash forward by Ares. That's going to be first blood coming in for ESC yet again. And Punch just way too greedy sticking around for that Gromp.
I mean, the greed was certainly there, but really opportunistic and aggressive play from Ares on his comfort Rek'Sai. Plenty of Rek'Sais will shadow their opponent. We've seen the likes of Score and Peanut do it, but to actually look for the kill, respect the fact the flash was down on the Gragas. Lane pressure was there for Roach, but not really any realistic time for him to walk over and help, so well played Ares, and once again, he's giving his team an advantage in the early game. It's just, where does it go from here?
Yeah, he needs to be able to further this pressure. I mean, did a wonderful job with it on Hecarim, so we've seen what he can do on this Rek'Sai. Be pretty sure that he's going to be able to maintain that pressure, but now in the bottom lane, Loken out of mana. Root's going to come through, does find Key. Guger's going low. Punch now arriving, just level 3, throws out a barrel.
Guger might die.
Loken, he's going to try to turn this one around. Yell. Guger's really low, still has the flash and exhaust up. But that was definitely a big turnaround for ESC, not going to get punished at all.
Yeah, it was fighting in a massive minion wave, was tanking the aggro solely as a Trundle. That's why it had to back away.
Solely as
not even on par, but I'll take it, Achilles.
All right, you're now the Korean Freak.
Just the title
do,
I want.
Do with that title how, with what you will. Do with it what you will. But, yeah, that's going to be some rough stuff there for Kongdu Monster yet again, not having too firm of legs to stand on in the early game. ESC fishing for more. He's going to be going in for some deep vision. Could walk back and find that pink as well. He's gonna sit in here, but he spotted Ares, finds the pink in the meantime. And honestly, Ares might just be able to get to a point where he can just solo out that Infernal Drake. They might not even have to bring the team down for it.
That would be...
Already having the Tiamat started is gonna be really nice for us.
That would definitely be massive for ESC. As Roach takes another trade from Fire Trap in top. But as we said, Malzahar and Jhin can really control chokes, but Ares, he's just interested in tracking Punch.
He's just trying to get Punch some PTSD here at this Gromp.
Two levels up on him now.
Yeah, this is pretty devastating here. More Punch. Hongu Monster as a whole, because he's just not able to get into a position where he can apply pressure. We saw how that gank went bottom. And it's just going to be a whole lot of that over and over again. Meanwhile, in mid, Temp going to get locked down, has those minions chipping away, has to go into the Sanguine Pool. And Edge going to be able to use the Nethergrasp to come out on top of that trade. Not able to get the Ghost with the Flash, though. And with Temp sustain on this Vladimir, he's still going to be relatively healthy.
They're actually considering, despite the low health value, to look for a dive onto Edge.
He's coming around as well. They have Vision of the River. The Pink Ward is there for ESC, so they know that they're not spotted out.
Poke away the passive. There it is.
Punches coming around. Edge taking a bunch of damage, but Ares not in a position to really tunnel in, and keeps backing down the river, so they won't be able to go for this dive. But Edge, he's going to have to stick around, wait to get these minions, so he doesn't fall further behind. But right now, he's down by 15 CS.
I mean, the big issue for Malzahar in the early game is he needs a Lost Chapter to have the mana regen to actually get through the laning phase. So went all in and was basically out of mana, and now with knowing that, Ares is pretty confident to go for an invade.
He's going to throw down the pink ward, might be just looking for that red steal away.
Punch
is going to go low, doesn't use the smite for the extra heal, and now he's going to get flash taunted on by Fire Trap. Exhaust coming through as well by Key, and that's going to be a second kill picked up for ESC. And Kongdu just misplaying this over and over again. Winners by not connecting on the Key, on the hunt, use Guger just trying to get back in underneath the tower. Lure's not going to connect, and now Loken taking this one up. Cannon Barrage comes down. This could
be
a turnaround for Kongdu Monster. Turret going in onto Ares. Fire Trap. One more shot. There it is. Souls will find it. Has the curtain call off the level 6. Looking for Loken. Second bullet goes really wide. Third one comes through. Fourth one connects onto him, and that's going to be the nice spell shield from Loken to keep himself alive. That could have been a quadra kill for Soul, but missing the first shot. Going to be really crucial there, but either way, good turnaround to get a kill onto the Jhin. Still on the backside of Kongdu Monster, specifically Punch misplaying in the jungle.
And look, Punch has certainly been shot down, but ESC's next decision to start tanking a turret with a Sivir and then against a Gangplank ult go for the four-man dive against two, against one, sure, you can pull it off, but ESC, that was almost a Spenu versus CJ Baron situation, because could have been a casual triple kill for the Jing to really head start what is going to be an armor penetration build. So if you gave him a free Yomu's Ghostblade at 9 minutes, I mean, the game would have turned on its head. So ESC, I really like the aggression out of Aeris. The next call, the one under the turret, was more reminiscent of what was happening in the late game in game one for ESC.
I'm just confused why Punch, like, you're already walking away from the red buff. You're going to be surrendering that. Why not just throw out the spike, get the heal off of the red, and then try to live that way? It just seemed a little bit questionable. He goes down. So far, the only one dying on the side of ESC. So if he has to be the sacrificial lamb, so that Kongju on the side of Kongju Monster. So if he has to be the sacrificial lamb for the team to have success, I'm sure he's willing to make that trade.
Definitely the Gragas over someone like Gangplank Malzahara Jhin. So as long as he's going to be able to find some pressure in his lanes and get some defensive vision. Usually it's the jungler laying down defensive vision for his lanes, but he needs a bit of protection here because Aeris has been super bloodthirsty from the jungle.
Edge still falling further and further behind here on the Malzahara.
Has that lost chapter now, so laning phase without blue buff is better, but Tempt is also a level 9 Vladimir, so whatever the meta, whatever the balance level, Vladimir at level 9 has always been someone you can't shove out, and Aeris not done.
And trying to just get the big ward, not able to find it, he's going to lose that ward of his own. Punch just gets shoved out yet again, sees that ward on the Krugs, and just can't stick around anywhere, even though Aeris is pretty much by himself. Needs the help from Guger to try to maintain this. Smite will come through. Ares is able to take that one away. Punch just losing jungle pressure.
Oh.
Really botched party cast coming through as well. Throws it on top of himself instead of behind him off of that body slam. So some mechanical misplays here on the Gragas. Punch really struggling.
But his mechanics were good on Nidalee. So what does that tell you, Achilles? The Ares is in his head. The pressure is getting to Punch, and what is not necessarily an elimination game, but a series that could put his team through to LCK. And Aeris is basically winning them the game by being the Battle Ward. He's doing the world's most impressive Peanut impersonation. And it means that Vladimir can overextend in mid. It means that Shen can overextend in other lanes. And this pressure game from ESC has completely unsettled Kongdu Monster's rhythm.
We really might be seeing another game where the jungler gets Flint Horizon. Right now it's 36 to 62, almost 30 CS up here for Ares. And that's all out of the jungle. He hasn't been in lanes, so waves, it's all been jungle creeps really. And he's just becoming an insurmountable force on this right side.
One variable that's working for Kongdu Monster is that Gangplank is keeping up with Shen, so at least Gangplank is hitting his power spikes, but I take what you're saying. Gragas is going to heavily struggle this game. We'll be going for Runeblade from the jungle as expected on a Gragas, but it will delay tankiness even further, and every buff is just fodder for Aeris to contest and potentially find a bonus kill on an enemy Gragas.
Now ESC going to be sitting up by 1.4 thousand gold. We'll be in a pretty comfortable spot for just 13 minutes into this game. Now with that Infernal Drink as well. These items coming through are going to be scaling that much better. Especially for somebody like Tempt, who's going to get that additional HP as well off of the AP that gets bumped up. Ares coming over the wall, might be looking for a play, but he gets slowed up by the barrel. He is just trying to stick in the face of Punch every opportunity he gets.
I mean, he just stole the opponent's blue, recalled Rek'Sai ults to bot, now is contesting every other camp on the map. The amount of freedom this gives his laners, he just casually smites away the Golem. I mean, this is reminiscent of the buffless game between Peanut and Flawless back in spring.
Yeah, Punch waiting for the spike to come up.
He got
able to get that one, but will he pay for this? Nice body slam out of the tunnel. Will allow him to exit safely. Tempt roaming down, going to take a hell of a lot of damage with the Reflecting Visions. But you just have to, I just feel bad for him at this point. This is like one of those games where you play in solo queue and you win so hard that you feel bad for the enemy team. And now just watching this, I really have to feel for Punch in this situation.
This feels like one of those games where the enemy Shaco is running your jungle. It's on Rek'Sai, a champion who has similar ability to pop over walls. Looking for a turret dive attempt.
Temp coming in, zipping in with the ghost. Will lock down with a hemo flag. Goes in for the Sanctuary Pool. Fire trap there to take up the rest of the tower. And another kill comes through for ESC. Now 3-1 on the board.
And it looked easy, but that's because of Aeris. Because he's been in the enemy jungle this whole time, there can't be any defensive vision. Because every time the Gragas enters his own jungle, he's being killed by the enemy Rek'Sai. The support and bottom lane has been rooted to lane because everywhere in the jungle is a risk to enter. And that just allows Temp to casually ghost from mid and turret dive, and there was no advance warning for gangplank because they don't have the map pressure, Kongu Monster, to even hope to get that.
Well, this is just yet another rough start here to the game for Kongu Monster, but if game one told us anything, it's that we cannot count them out. We cannot count on ESC to play this perfectly throughout. Now Drake going to be spawning up next. Kongu definitely going to want to get their hands on that, because that combined with Infernal Drake from ESC will just spell disaster.
You just wonder how ESC could possibly botch this game. When in the late game, Sivir presses ult, Shen ults the ulties the Vladimir, he already has the proto belt. We know how the rest of that goes, so, you know, Weaver's Wall plus a Hecarim setup, there's definitely some skill cap there, but this is pretty much press R and win for ESC ever. And when they have a gold lead on a comp that outscales Kongu Monster, outscales basically any enemy comp you can put together, Aeris has done them such a solid in the early game, two games in a row, but this one, this is a massive lead for ESC.
I mean, look at this time and time again. He can't even get his Raptors. Crying out loud, Aeris is here to pick this one up yet again. Never mind, they'll hand it over to Temp. And Punch just keeps getting denied. Still two levels down. Now, Kongu Monster might be looking for the fight. He's going to go low. Cast used. And one hit away from getting locked up. They jump forward, trying to get this kill onto Aeris. Soul now joining the fight. Has the curtain call up. Misses the first shot on the key. Will land the second one. Aeris is out of range. Last shot comes in. Next on the Loken, attempt has to flash away. Kongu Monster doing a good job of turning this one on its head. Fire trap going to get silenced out, rooted down, has to flash away. Has the Malefic Vision sticking away on him. Is it enough to finish him off? Looks like the answer is going to be no. He barely stays alive. Now Soul is in no man's land, flashes and tries to get the kill on the Loken, but loses vision as he enters the brush. And that is going to be a 2-for-1 still in favor of ESC. But a crucial kill picked up for Kongu Monster at the same time. But they have to hightail it the hell out of this jungle. Barrel not going to connect as Temp goes into the Sanguine Pool, pops the ghost, but won't be able to find much else. And that is still just going to be ESC coming away with another kill on top of Kongu.
Yeah, big over pursuit by first ESC ever, then Kongu Monster, baited by all that low health members. They were tanky members and people like Vladimir that can drop aggro. Looking for first brick, but Edge hasn't recalled, so we'll be able to re-enter lane. Has enough mana to wave clear.
Seems to stick around here tonight, Temp. Wait for him to go back. He can safely do so, but look at this bottom side of the jungle of Kongu Monster lit up like a Christmas tree by ESC. We'll take a look at this fight, though. Big over pursuit to start things off.
When Aeris has done this work so hard, that's why even his teammates feel strong enough to come and contest the enemy Raptor camp. But the reason why I said Kongu Monster wanted to focus on Dragon Control is that Malzahar Jhin is a deadly combo. Suppression into the curtain call. This is Yomu's Ghostblade, fairly early Jhin. And he can put in damage from so far away, relative safety, that it looks like Kongu would really turn around this fight, but this should have been the end of it. This is when you back away, Fire Trap doesn't die. No one else needed to die here, and Kongu would have done a pretty even trade, but Soul kind of walked into no man's land, and ESC got that bonus kill.
Yeah, you look at Fire Trap, suddenly you glance back down the river, and you're like, oh, well, the Jhin is dead. I'm sure Soul feels silly about that one, but he's continue on his build path looking for that Duskblade. Has the BF sword at the moment. A very slight lead over top of Loken. Meanwhile, it's like, oh, no team fights going on. Aeris just going to pinch right back into the jungle and try to screw with punches as much as he possibly can as his red buff comes back. Top user is here to support. There's no smite here for Punch, so he is most certainly going to lose this one. He's getting locked up by the Kukans of Blows. Aeris takes away the red. Soul firing off over the wall, trying to find the kill. Stand United being used now on the key. As the Nethergrass comes through, they're going to try to finish out the Rek'Sai. He makes it to the back of the pit, and he is going to be fine. Cougar is able to take down Key, but he goes down, but rather Punch goes down as he gets finished off by Fire Trap. Soul is finally able to pick himself up a kill as he does kill Aeris, gets those very crucial double buffs. Fire Trap still pushing forward, trying to zone him out. But meanwhile, Roach is just looking for that first brick gold, and he's going to be able to find it. This is going to be a massive win for Call of Duty Monster. A 2-for-1 plus the first tower gold.
Yeah, 2-for-1 that they won, even though Roach wasn't able to respond and teleport. He could only throw down the ultimate, but the ultimate placement you will see on the replay is excellent from Roach. And they keep opting into fights where Eris and now Ki were overextended. This time, Malzahar had the wave pushed out, so he responded first. Jhin will always respond faster than Sivir, which sounds crazy. Sivir has the ultimate and moves fast, but he just pops the curtain call, has a lot of armor penetration early, and was doing damage and taking out members before ESC could ever come together. And 5v5 comp, it works really well in the open, but when they're fighting around terrain like they were, ESC lost out.
They did, and now, lucky for them, they didn't lose out on much more other than that first tower. So Mount Drake is here, and Monkey Monster certainly would love to have that for themselves, but now, this doesn't look all that likely. Started up by ESC, Kongju not really in a position to respond. Roach running down the river, doesn't have a teleport here, but you see they might just feel back. Now just looking to pull it further out of the pit so they can continue on.
Roach doesn't even have the Gankmag ultimate available, so not right. Even a semi-global. So
all right, Punch, it's time for the big COD explosive cast.
Reset, so this is taking longer and longer.
Just gonna throw out the barrel and try to trigger it this way, but can he get it?
Ooh.
Oh, very, very close down. Key jumping away, can't barrage to the back. He flashes away. They're body blocking so well away from this curtain call, and the Braum will be able to make it out alive. Very well-timed flash by him to get out of that cannonball. Barrage there in the end, but still, good pressure coming through from Kong Ju. They'll lose that Mountain Drake. They can't afford to lose much more from this point on. It's just 400 gold separating, but with that Infernal and Mountain ticking up for ESC, it's really going to enable them in these fights and in the objective game as the time goes on.
Malzahar scaling with the Infernal Drake. Just outstanding. Obviously gets the extra health from the passive as well. Mountain and Infernal means that if they win a fight, they will really have the resources with a fairly short-range comp to take out the objective and blow this game open. So, two very consequential Drakes. Another Mountain will be the third spawn. They just need to coordinate their pressure a little bit better. Early in the game, you can make these crazy invades as a Rek'Sai. You're very escapable. Can get in the face of the enemy, but last couple of times been ill-advised aggression from ESCM.
Now looks like they might be able to knit themselves their first turn of the game as the bottom tier one is pretty exposed. Loken pushing in here. Ares just waiting for the rush. So rather than going for the tower, they're looking for the gank. Ares boots in, not going to get the knockup onto Guger. Coming around the side. Get rid of that tunnel system. Really stop their engagement potential. Edge going to walk forward. There's a ward down. Spots tempted the brush near red. Punch yet again going for his Krugs. Will he be able to get it this time? Looks like the answer is yes. Ares going to get rooted. But not going to be a whole lot more follow-up coming through on that. Edge just really roaming down to ensure that his bot lane can arrive underneath the tower safely, clear out these waves, and make sure that Punch can finally get the Krugs.
We're still keeping up this turret longer than you'd expect. Very much going to be a matter of time for ESC to take it out. But for now, we are keeping it afloat, denying any extra gold to open up this lead for ESC ever.
I mean, turrets have been slow in both games. You think back to, you know, the last one, Kongdu had such a hard time taking anything beyond that first turret that they got. This didn't go so well for them, but now Temp pushing forward, knowing how low that turret was in mid. He's able to just force that one out. Ares arriving on the flank, just in case he would be needed.
Turrets have always been the ultimate objective in League of Legends, the mid turret before Drake changed a couple of times, always seen as the ultra objective. I think back to OMG in Season 3 and all their focus around taking down an outer mid lane turret, getting Blitzcrank hooked. Loken's caught here.
He's going to get locked down. Flashes away, but here comes Punch on the backside. Flash body slam to find the kill. Throws out the explosive cast. And with that Duskblade, that is going to be a swift 2 kills picked up by Kongdu Monster. Soul finding his fourth. Now 4-for-6. 100% kill contribution thus far in this game, and another turret going down for Kongdu Monster. Nice plays around the bottom lane. They're starting to pick up the pace.
It was so easy and calculated for Ares to counter the top side blue jungle, but because it's been bot side focused, the curtain call has done so much work that it's really let Sol get massively ahead as the Duskblade and the Yomu's fast. Now it's going to be working into the more Malmortius. If ESC continue to play aggressive around the top side, they'd be denying blue buff from a Malzahar, and there'd be no way for the Hail Mary curtain calls to react because they focus on that bot side. It's really opened up Sol to be a massive factor in this game.
Yeah, which is really crucial here for the side of Kong Yuvans. Let's take another look at this engagement bot. Wonderfully timed, getting that root in, and then punch arrives at the exact moment that he was needed.
I mean, at the end of the day, that's honestly on key. He needs to be blocking the Deadly Flourish. Kind of left it there. The Unbreakable was kind of nothing doing, so that was key kind of failing his AD carry. And when they talked about the difference between the two, they saw Totoro as the laning AD carry and key as the roaming AD carry, and you're kind of seeing the proof right there.
I mean, the roams have been working out overall, but now ESC, after some of that over-aggression, has just been slipping up and losing out. So we'll see if they're able to stop the bleeding here. Still only going to be 900 gold separating as Kongqiu has the lead for the first time in the game. But with this next Mountain Drake spawning in a minute and 20 seconds, ESC certainly want to net that for themselves, have that double Mountain Drake, and be able to knock down structures and Baron that much more easily. Kongqiu is going to be their first dragon that they're trying to put on the board.
ESC were fighting so hard around the outer bot lane turret because if you get mid and bot down, these roams are higher effectiveness. It's much harder for the waves to be in the right space for Kongqiu to actually collapse and punish Aeris, but they've managed to keep that bot lane turret alive, and that's why ESC have to hold back a little bit. So Aeris really needs to kind of hold back and temper that aggression. Not going to be the Flame Horizon, but he has been consistently around the 40 to 45 CS ahead of the Grots.
We're now taking a look at that top lane. It's a bit of a sleeper lane so far. Seeing Firecraft arrives, some cannon barrages in for Roach, but overall, not a whole lot of action happening directly between these guys. Trinity Force into that Yomu, as well as very early Lord Dominic's Regards coming through, so just trying to really cut through that Shen. And you can see he's yet again working on that Titanic Hydra for himself, really get that split pressure going, but it seems like Roach is having a much more stable time in Elena in the second time around game two.
And that's what ESC gave Kongqiu Monster. That's not, I'm not talking about the draft there where it's the Gangplank and Shen kind of being picked into each other, but Aries focusing on the bot side. We mentioned the fact that the blue buffs would go over to Malzahar more reliably. There weren't the turret dives onto the Gangplank that we saw consistently in game one, this time for ESC, so safe farming means three item Gangplank in 26 minutes.
Roach gonna be really satisfied with that now. Looks like the group up is coming in the river as the dragon has respawned. Another team going to be looking to pull the trigger on this one. Yet Aries goes in, sticking inside of that brush, gets the pop-up. But now the fight just completely blowing up right in the middle of the river. TP coming through from Roach as he tries to join in with the squad. Aries takes a big chunk of damage. Another curtain call opened up, trying to snipe out Loken or Temp. But Fire Trap is there to body block.
But, hey!
But there we go. Sol, he spots a key and he takes him out. Temp going in with the Sentry pull. Has big burst of damage coming through. ESC starting to turn this one around. Now Sol, nowhere to go, nowhere to flash. He is going to fall. A kill picked up for Loken, and suddenly Roach is the only one left on Kongqiu Monster. A 1-for-4 so far, looking for the fifth. They won't be able to find it, but they can go right for the Baron here. It's 28 minutes. Tempt is still tanky, as is Fire Trap. And man, what a turnaround from ESC. It looked like Kongqiu Monster had that one in the bag.
Trying to collapse onto a Vladimir is always just the wrong decision. They overlapped CC a bit. They didn't have kill pressure onto him, and Loken had no one closing him down. Ricochet crits and the Hema Plague, enough said. And ESC, they get the maximum out of the over-pursual from Kongqiu Monster.
Now Roach just trying to find a blue buff. The only reprieve he could have gotten out of that. We'll take a look at this fight yet again.
He starts out great. The first person to die is Aries, the person with smite. So it should be happy times for Kongqiu Monster. This time Roach is better on the teleport. They take down a member. You look at this and you're like, okay, things are going pretty well. Aries does live, sorry, apologies, but Key is the one who goes down to the curtain call. And then they turn onto Tempt. Very tanky already. Watch Loken free hitting the ricochets and the Hemo Plague. We're already at high damage territory for that Sivir, and Loken just destroyed Kongqiu Monster.
Yeah, double kill there for Tempt, and that Hemo Plague able to Amplified Damage just really doing work. And now that should be a second Mount Drake going over to PSC as well. Kongdu now starting to get shit out of this game where suddenly, you know, they had a lead and just like that, the snap of a finger and ESC just take it all back. Double Mountain Drake plus Baron empowered minion waves pushing in. They should be able to storm the base of Kongdu Monster with relative ease.
If you look at the item builds and you realize that, you know, Infinity Edge almost completed for Loken. When that comes through, there's a Glacial Shroud, a Ninja Tabi, and no other armor on the side of Kongdu Monster. And that's what happens when you have a Gangplank top. That's just a reality. You're going to have a very squishy front line, and Vladimir Siva will run over them if it's a true 5v5. Pick power is good with the Deadly Flourish and the Malzahar ult, but the true 5v5, we mentioned it during Champion Select, it's just not something that Kongdu Monster can hope to have.
This is where things start getting pretty rough. Seoul obviously investing into this armor penetration build this time around rather than the scaling with the Essence Reaver, as he did in game one. So ESC getting these leads is going to be considerably harder time for him to be as impactful.
Frontline now has Sunfire Cape, most of a Guardian Angel, and then just a straight out Guardian Angel on the Rek'Sai. So suddenly, armor penetration doesn't look like it's getting a lot of value unless they catch out one of the squishes.
Good luck popping in Ares at this point. New monster grouping up in bottom. Pretty much all five members hovering around this area just to clear out the waves. Just hold on to these structures as long as they possibly can. Fire Trap is pushing up top. We're gonna have to go answer that as well as this wave in mid that has been building up pretty strong. It's still gonna have a decent amount of wave clear, but you can see even with Tempest and Vladimir, still able to do a good amount of damage to that tower with just the auto attacks.
They're pushing three lanes with Baron buff. It's the dream. Usually this is not something that can happen because engage from the side of someone like an Ashe can really punish playing three lanes, but the engage for Kongdu, it's only Punch who's been bodied out of lane multiple times, so not respecting the Gragas, playing three lanes.
Here comes in on the 10th, they're gonna go ahead, pop the Nethergrass, pop him in as well. Stand United is there, now Fire Trap arrives. Olympic Vision's coming through, but the shield is there and he'll stay alive in the end. But it was a good way to stop any further push coming through from ESC, so Kongdu just doing the best that they can. Was that tier 2 now looking to hold on to the tier 1. And bottom Baron buff is going to expire, so they will be able to do so. So overall, for a double Mountain Drake team with Baron, Kongdu held on to their structures very well.
I agree, but the fact that ESC could play three lanes, and also the fact that ESC in a real world 5v5 kind of has to turret dive given the comp that they have. They only have Vladimir and Sivir as ranged auto attackers, and Sivir has that short range, so their turret taking threat in a siege is very poor. The fact that they got away with playing three lanes and they didn't even have to take the risk of diving because it was taking risks in game one that really allowed Kongdu Monster to get back into the game. It was a no risk in a turret, so that's still pretty happy days for ESCM.
Sure. I'm just saying there's a bit of a silver lining there for Kongdu. Still not looking very good as far as the potential of them closing this game out, but it's definitely a nice little silver lining for them.
Didn't lose the maximum. Yeah. Not the best silver lining, but you take what you can get, I guess.
Only half of the glass build. That's the way that you can look at that.
So is it half empty or half full?
Yes.
Okay.
You know, pitcher on the backside, Roach away
this
from that tower. They're going to try to get on to Loken. He's exhausted out, but he's still just way too damn fast, so he won't be able to lock him down. He blocks that fourth and final bullet, won't take any damage for it. And the Grunt Call will be down. Another tier 2 falls, so I'm in the bottom side, so just one more outer turret standing for Kongdu Monster in the top side of the map. Gonna be do or die time for them pretty soon. Might just have to go for some sort of Hail Mary to try to claw their way back into this game, because at the moment they're down by 6,600 gold.
I mean, the money way to play this game for ESC is to take as many inner turrets as possible, then set up around Baron. That's where Kongdu will have to overextend. Sivir ult, Vladimir, the rest we know very clearly what will happen, so they're taking the inner turrets both in mid and bot lane, and now ESC going to play exclusively around Baron for the next couple of minutes and just wait for Kongdu Monster to make a mistake.
Baskets are sticking around as several members waiting to flank inside of the jungle, but they're all backing off. They're on the hunt back up yet again, so it looks like he's going to peel up the lane, get out to safety, and spend this gold that they have fought quite hard to pick up. 1,600 in the inventory of this Sivir at the moment. So him going back. Now it's going to be that mortal reminder coming through. So has that Doran's Blade, so we'll be looking for that sixth and final item, whether or not he wants to go for a Bloodthirster again, like we saw in game one.
Speaking of itemization, though, really don't understand Roach going for Infinity Edge. It's an item that's pretty much cycled out of most Gangplank builds, and more Malmortius, no Guardian Angel. He's just going to die instantly, and he's against a armor-stacking team. There's a Thornmail on Aeris now. Like, in a game where the enemy side is all squishy, sure, Infinity Edge crit might win you a fight. But if Gangplank is in range to parlay the Sivir, something really wrong happened for ESC, because he should be dying well before that moment.
Yeah, questionable overall. Not having anything defensive is just really bizarre. And you can already see Guger getting worked down. Has to bop that locket there for the shield. And ESC, looking to just finish this push in and take this last outer turret. Fire Trap's already splitting in the bottom lane, trying to get that wave caught up into that inhibitor tower.
They've had so much pressure that it's only going to be blue trinkets for warding around Baron. It's cleared out. Just waiting for ESC to continue to push the vision. You know, they could even count time. Okay, it's been a couple of minutes. They couldn't, if there were wards, they would have timed out. And then the Baron will be the objective push for ESC ever.
ESC maybe looking for the pinch here. He coming in, flashes over, gets a knock up in on the punch. They're going for Guger, work him low. One more hit will do it. There it is, Loken coming up with the kill.
Now
the dive
try.
In under punch. He is not long for this world as he goes down, and the rest of the Hungry Monsters is scrambling to try to get back into the base. He's taking a hell of a lot of damage. Fires back, one shot on the temp. Can't get a whole lot back off of that one. It looks like the inhibitor line might be getting broken here at the 36-minute mark.
If Double mountain.
Just the game, if they can just continue pushing.
Yeah, double mountain Drake, infernal Drake, super easy to break through the base with a couple of members dead.
Yeah, that's going to be the inhibitor going down. Conky Monster pushing back forward, Soul playing really far up. Roach trying to find the barrel chain, but doesn't even throw out the third one. Curtain call. Find a couple of hits, tempt. Going to eat some of these with the fourth one. Dodge shot by the Sacred Bull. They work down Fire Trap, but he's still got the Guardian Angel. They might have bought enough time so that ESC can't go for the Baron. Punch is coming back up in 6 seconds, so it looks like it will be so. But now the inhibitor line down, ESC, they can just bait out, wait for the lane to shove up with the super creeps, and then try to go in for that Baron. And create that pressure, draw Kongdu monster out of the base, and just wipe him clean.
You mentioned the ESC Baron. This is actually Kongdu being like, okay, the one way we can get back into this game is maybe force a Baron, even with their jungler only now getting through from base with home guard boots. Quickly, ESC assert their dominance, so it's going to be way clear for Kongdu.
Void Rush there. Quite nice. ESC. There are options available to them. Baron would be the most desirable, but they could also just turn in for this Elder Dragon, have three buffs, the most valuable ones that could possibly be stacked up and amplified by that Elder Dragon. But now, ESC. We're starting a two-man Baron here with Key and Temp. Loken roaming down. They're now going to know that this is happening, but it's already so low. They do so much damage because of those double mountains. They're going to be able to take this one away.
Yeah, Punch gets the bad news as the sound cue plays around the map. They could have just taken Elder Drake and forced Kongdu to opt into a fight against an Elder Dragon dub team taking Baron, but go for the two-man play, doesn't get punished. Kongdu returns to their base, tails between their legs, and can't really see this going any other way than a tied series after two games.
Yeah, looks like we might just have a series on our hands rather than a 3-0 shutout. Kongdu just not able to maintain the level of play that we saw in game one, letting the lead slip between their fingers yet again. That fight around the river some time ago.
Worth knowing that Aeris was the one who, Ares here, Aeris, however you want to say it, Ares really blew open this game.
Oh, for sure.
The job he did on Punch was solo queue-esque. You don't usually see a jungler so well held, there wasn't really options for his lanes to respond, so He's been basically a non-factor the whole game. And even though there was some over-pursuers, even though it wasn't the cleanest, it was the Rek'Sai that really was the difference this game.
Yeah, now, Roku Monster are going to be looking for another inhibitor. They have Roach up top, trying to deal with fire trap, and just pushing forward, empowered by Baron. This is just going to make life very difficult for Kongdu Monster as the rest of this game goes on. Mid-inhib turret already about to go down. A couple more hits here just from Temp. We'll finish this thing off, but he has to peel back. Worried about that Nethergrass that has been being held out by Edge so far.
12% bonus AD and AP and 30% bonus damage to structures. Means that anyone is deleting structures on the side of ESC Ever.
More hits here by Drapture. I think that pinch in from above. That's going to be on the hunt pop. We were getting slowed up by that Winter's Bite, and the inhibitor is going to go down. He's going to get locked up. Bird call open, but he has the Unbreakable. The Cannon Barrage coming down. They find Loken with a couple of these hits. Keep going low. Sand United being used,
he's
but
dead.
They're able to pop him in the end. So they lose the turret. They don't lose that inhibitor. Fire Trap, he'll dash over the wall with a Shadow Dash. Self-save. They find a pick, but it's on the key. Kongdu Monster, they're not going to be able to capitalize on that. There's nothing really for them to push. They already have all the tier ones except for mid. And shoving that far up the mid lane would just make them that much more susceptible to be collapsed on by the remaining members of ESC, who can still win that fight 4v5.
They just don't really have a realistic way to get the second, the third pick. Malzahar's not able to get into ult range because he has to worry about the turnaround threat from the likes of Vladimir and Sivir, let alone the CC from Rek'Sai and Shen. So one kill after you lose your mid lane inhibitor turret is going to give Kongdu Monster very much little reward. They're going to get a bit of farming, very safe farming for their carries, but next to nothing.
Yeah, the game will just keep going on and on from here. 12,600 gold now for ESC.
This build from Roche. Hilarious, he went for Phantom Dancer last, so there's a reason why melee carries have never really existed in League of Legends, because if you walk into melee range, you die instantly.
Yeah, Loken does a lot of damage, and I don't know if Roach is going to be able to chain the barrels well enough. He's already missed his combo multiple times, so it hasn't been looking that good.
Well, he has base health and armor and magic resistance values as well, so it's 2400 health with 70 armor and 80 magic resist. That's not going to do you a whole lot.
Yeah, he's just going to melt it out, speaking of which. Inhibitors now in mid and top, looking to go down. More hits here.
But he doesn't do any damage to Fire Trap either.
Yeah, it gets a little bit off of that barrel, but you can see it's just still not a whole lot. That's going to be inhibit mid falling and Fire Trap continuing the split in top. ESC are just looking to bleed Kongdu Monster out slowly and surely. And it's working pretty well.
Kongdu's frontline options are a support Trundle, a jungler who's been crushed, and a no defense gangplank. So I think the Trundle probably wins that war, which is a bit awkward given the support Trundle.
Crushes the old jungle, does his punch.
Ah. Was crushed though. It's the only important thing to really take away.
I can only imagine how bad this game would be if Kongdu Crush was playing.
Oh boy.
Would it be, it might be just a swift 3-0 if that were the case. Crush is definitely not proven himself from Spring Split. And just goes to show that with punch starting, he is the better option for the team. But Fire Trap, he's going to keep being a thorn in the side for Kongdu and look to take away another inhibitor tower. Last non-Nexus turret standing on the map here for Kongdu. Help attempt, they should be able to get this. Couple more hits, Ares roaming down as well. There it is. Inhib open, it's going to fall. These two members now, three of Kongdu on the bottom side of the map. That should be the top inhib going down relatively soon. Soul and Cougar trying to hold on to that one, but I don't know for how much longer they can do so.
At any point, ESC can pull the trigger and turret dive. They're so far ahead. But they want to take the tutorial victory. That's all inhibitor turrets down, and just the Nexus left for ESC to take game two.
Yeah, looking like this might just be the end of it. Fire Trap goes in, locks up. Soul, he flashes away, but it doesn't matter. He goes down. That's going to be the kill going over to Ares, and now Punch going low will be finished off by Loken. Stand United on the Tempest as he takes up the turret. We'll keep him alive and healthy. And that is going to be them shoving back Roach, taking out the Nexus Towers, and ESC will claim Game 2 in 44 minutes time, 8-15 in the end, a massive gold lead for them, and they're going to make this a series. They do not want to get shut out in a 3-0 in this very crucial match where they can just go ahead, advance onto LCK, and avoid that second best of five on Saturday.
Greedy late-game focused draft was enabled by Ares playing so aggressively in the early game, being the battle ward the Peanut was often said to be, and his aggression opened up the lane. They had so much freedom because there was never going to be a jungler who was multiple levels behind, who was basically always in vision range of the Rek'Sai. So credit to Ares. If there was an MVP in these relegation playoffs, he certainly would be it. And Hungry Monster were petrified in fear at the sight of the Rek'Sai, and later the sight of the team fights with Vladimir, Sivir, and Shen in full flood.
Yeah, I mean, you can see Edge doing a good amount of damage here with that Malzahar, the highest of the champions in the game, but overall just was not enough to close it out. Kongdu, that big fight in River, really let the game slip through their fingers. We're going to go to a quick break, though. When we come back, we will have game 3, so don't go anywhere.